I was a student at Syracuse, I was just in my room one night late playing records, and with two friends, we had old blues records, and Ray Charles and Lightnin' Hopkins and things. And suddenly there came a knock on the door, and we thought it was the person in charge of the dormitory coming down to complain, because that's usually what happened. And instead it was the guy upstairs, who turned out to be Lou, and he needed records because he had a campus radio show, and he was running out of blues and that sort of thing. And my roommate was a guy named Bob Davidson, and he was a big collector. So, and I had my things too. So Lou borrowed some records, and that's when we first met, and we had made plans to, you know, have him see what all we had, but he was kicked off the radio show before we ever did much of that. We actually lent him just about a few albums. And then one other day, Lou was pretty guarded about himself, but he did let it be known that he was an English major and that he liked to write poetry, and he didn't say anything about playing music. And then one day, the ROTC, which is a military training program that they have in colleges, their people are out marching around. There's an athletic field behind the dorm, and suddenly we could hear this real loud humming and buzzing upstairs, and then it was somebody playing electric guitar at full volume. So then I knew that Lou was a guitar player too, and then we just went from there.
Okay, I want everybody to settle down now. We got some news on the show, and so I'll knock you dead when we come outside your head. You get ready? You said he'll go, yeah. All right, come on. Come on. Come on, let's go. Yeah. All right, everybody get down on your face, man. Get ready, yeah.
Training, so far as I know, it's always pretty hard to pry things out of Lou about his childhood, because of his odd relationship with his parents and all that sort of thing. But it would come out in little pieces. But he was trained on piano, apparently, because he can play piano some, but he didn't pursue it at all seriously. And then he had some little teeny bands, you know, the way we all did. But Lou went one step further than I did, and a step further than almost anybody does. He actually made a record. John's background is a lot better documented, but John also didn't want to talk about it, and still doesn't, because when we first met him, he was rebelling against his formal training. It used to drive us crazy. In order to copyright a song, you have to come out with a lead sheet, which is just a transcription by notes, and you put down the lyrics. For Lou and I, for Lou and me, it was very difficult to do these things. You know, we have to sit around, well, what notes are they, and how to write music. We can read and write music, but it's hard, you have to think. John could do it instantly, but refused. We could never get him to do the lead sheets. I said, John, it would only take you a minute. Nope, didn't want to hear about it. So if we used to ask John, well, what about your training? He didn't want to talk about it. But I know that he started piano at 3 and viola at 5 and played on the BBC when he was 8 because he was considered a prodigy. John doesn't talk about that either. It doesn't make that much difference to him. But he always could really play. By reputation, didn't know anything about him in particular, except that he was this artist and I would summarize his public image at the time. He was a pop artist, and he had already started to make films. In one of the underground film showings, he contributed a piece or two, which you basically couldn't look at, eat, or kiss, or one of those things. So I didn't know anything about him. And we weren't art groupies, so it didn't. But then he started talking about doing the show, and that did get our interest. It was kind of what we'd been doing with underground films, except this time we would come out from back behind the screen. We did and we didn't, because in the context of the show with projections, you could hardly ever see us anyway. the show, we weren't trying to get the spotlight, incidentally. It wasn't the Velvet Underground up front, and all this stuff behind us just as backdrop. As a matter of fact, we weren't in front. We were on stage, and then in front of us were the dancers, whoever they might be, Gerard, Mary, Ronnie Catrone, and all their props. So if there's anything to look at, you might look at them, because they were much more mobile and active than we were. So you might want to look at the foreground dancing, or you might want to look at the background, films, lights, and all the rest of it. The Velvet Underground, well, they're someplace spread out in and among the equipment. You know, we had big piles of amplifiers. You could hide behind them if you felt like. So we weren't the... we didn't consider ourselves the center of attraction. If the show had a star, and it wasn't Andy, then it would be Gerard or someone doing something spectacular, be the dancers. But we played the music. I knew more about Nico. I could say a lot about her. She was always very mysterious to us in the band. We were not widely traveled. We were not sophisticated. We were just suburban brats, except for John. John had traveled, but didn't have any money in particular. Nico was this glamorous European model and movie star and all this kind of thing. So we didn't know quite what to make of her, except that she could sing. And I always will insist on that. She was not there just simply to stand up and be beautiful. We didn't need that. We had beautiful people dancing. And Maureen was the sister of an old friend of mine, who also went to Syracuse and also was, you know, friends with Lou. And so when Angus left, we had no drummer. And Maureen had been playing with a girls band in Long Island, and they broke up. And so she just came in to do, just to do a little percussion and just fool around. I don't know, it was very casual. And since she was willing to do different things, then she stayed.
because you haven't heard the new Velvet Underground. Here are expressions of a new dimension in honesty, purity, in feeling. The Velvet Underground. Not a probe, not an exploration, not an experiment, but a whole complete reality. The Velvet Underground. The Velvet Underground. This is you. You'll find your love, your hope, your reality. The Velvet Underground on MGM Records will tell you how to feel. Listen.
West Coast was an amazing experience, the only way I could describe it. None of us had ever been out there. And we knew it was a separate world, but we weren't quite sure just how separate it might be. And we liked it a lot, but it was very intimidating also, because musically the West Coast was an organized force trying to predominate in the pop scene at the time. I remember we were in our rental car coming back from the airport, and I turned on the radio. The first song that came out was Monday, Monday. And I said, well, I don't know. Maybe we're not ready for this sort of thing yet. Wild Light White Heat was a real frustration because we wanted to do something electronic and energetic, and we had the energy and we had the electronics. What we didn't take into account was whether or not it could be recorded. If we went into a studio now and did White Light, White Heat, it would work because they have the equipment. Then they didn't. So there's an incredible leakage from track to track. There were ways we could have done it if we'd all played individually, but we didn't like to. We liked to play simultaneously and use voiceover live a lot of times. So we didn't know that the album was doomed until we actually mixed it down. Well, right after the White Light, White Heat era, the album came out and we played and we were having good times in the band. So that's why it was so strange that Lou should suddenly want John out. I don't remember any reason really being given except that this would be some general statement that he couldn't stand, you know, playing with John anymore for, you know, umpteen inexpressible reasons. I always had my own weird interpretations. I don't recall Lou ever giving an exact reason for not wanting John there. But John was playing great, so it wasn't anything that he was falling down musically. His personal habits were commendable. He was running around with Betsy Johnson and was very well dressed and responsible. He was making, so he was doing fine. a true story of successful rehabilitation of a classical musician. So I don't know, maybe Lou got jealous. I would attribute it to something like that. Not that John was easy to work with, but was Lou, was I. Suggested after he left that that he and I pick it up and start all over with the, you know, different manager and get back to the way it was at the beginning. The way it was at the beginning wasn't going to include Cal. We weren't going that far back, apparently. I don't know why I didn't do it. I was pretty soured on pop music in general at the time. And I was mad at Lou for who knows what all. but I hadn't been very friendly to him for the preceding couple of months. And Lou, at the time, accepted responsibility for that. Said it was his fault because he was on these crazy diets and things. I just didn't. I already thought that perhaps we accomplished enough, that to start all over would be to start rolling the rock uphill again. That it would take us... I know one of the lines I used to Lou was that it would... I guess I was trying to tell him not to leave. That even if we did do it, that it would take us 3 years to get back to the point that we were at right the minute we were talking. He said, if we do all these things, just to get back to where we are, would take, I was, you know, picking a number, 3 years, maybe I said 2 years. But, and then there was no certainty that we would do it anyway. So, I don't know, I'd kind of decided to go back to school, get away from all that sort of thing. Yeah, I was pretty disillusioned.
This is the way the Velvet Underground would have played it without me.